I'd like you to turn to Hebrews chapter 11. We've been studying this chapter, many call the faith chapter in the Bible. Chapter 11, verse 17 mentions Abraham. It says, by faith Abraham, when he was what? Tried. Abraham was tried. That's kind of should put you in mind of Job. Job was tried. His faith was tested by many things happening. But it wasn't that God was trying to do things in Job's life to see him get saved by doing works or responding to these calamities. Rather, he was trying to demonstrate that Job was a man of God. Job had the righteousness of faith. Job would do the right thing no matter what happened in his life, and those trials were to demonstrate that Job believed God. And same with Abraham here. If God says, I'm going to give you a son, and you're in your 90s, late 90s, almost 100 years old, whenever you receive this son that you and your wife have been trying to have a child for your entire married life, and your wife's barren, and then all of a sudden God demonstrates after 15 years after he promised Abraham a son, that Sarah conceives, and they have a child. And then God says, take the child up and sacrifice him. Now, the Abrahamic covenant, I'll make of you a great nation, and I'll bless the other families of the earth, the other nations that bless you and your nation, and I'll curse those that curse you and your nation. That's the Abrahamic covenant. Through Abraham, Israel is going to be the head of all nations. And Abraham's seed is going to be this great nation that's going to be the head of all the rest of the nations, and the rest of the nations are subservient under the Abrahamic covenant. That's why so many nations hate Israel, because that means they're going to have to be submissive and in subjection to the nation of Israel. And they hate the Jews and resent them for this promise from God. And yet, that promise to Abraham is given to him, and then God says, now go up and sacrifice that son. And it's through that son, if you're going to inherit the land, all the land that God promised to Abraham as an everlasting possession, then that means that God was promising to Abraham eternal life. Abraham never, by the way, was given possession of the land in his earthly lifetime. Abraham died, and his grandson has the 12 patriarchs, and those 12 tribes go into Egypt and come out 400 years later as God promised Abraham, and then they go into the land, and God gives under the leadership of Joshua, they subdue the Gentiles in the land, and God gives them the land long after Abraham lived. And so the point is, Abraham was promised the land. It was promised to him and his seed as an everlasting possession. Well, that's going to be received, inherited in resurrection life for Abraham. And so the promise is resurrection life for those in the nation of Israel who never possessed the land as an everlasting possession. They had it temporarily in time past under their kings, but was not able to hold on to the land because of the curses that came from the law covenant, the old covenant. And God promised them that he would give them, under the new covenant, he would make them a righteous nation to inherit that all the blessings that he promised through Abraham. The Abrahamic covenant would be fulfilled by the new covenant, and Christ's blood shed at Calvary is the way that God makes that nation righteous and able to receive the land as an everlasting possession out there, and he's going to reign over the nation of Israel and rule the world through the nation of Israel as a nation of priests in that day out there in the millennium. And so we've studied that in Hebrews here, in chapter 11, he says about Abraham, he said, by faith Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac. And he that received the promises offered up his only begotten son, of whom it was said that in Isaac shall thy seed be called, accounting that God was able to raise him up, even from the dead, from whence also he received him in a figure. So this is this whole chapter, as we'll see, we're going to begin, we're going to try to continue down beginning in verse 3 this morning, or we've talked about the first two verses, and verse 2, verse 1, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it, the elders obtained a good report. Now, obtaining a good report is different than faith unto eternal life. Obtaining a good, the things that you do because you believe God, that's service unto God. That's we call it practical sanctification. There's a positional sanctification. When you trust Christ died for your sins, God the Holy Spirit separates you, sanctifies you, separates you as holy unto God by identifying you with Christ. God indwells you, lives in you. He seals you until the day of your redemption, the redemption of your body that will happen at the rapture. You're sanctified the moment you trust the gospel positionally. In Christ, you're sanctified. You have His righteousness. You're holy unto God. But practically, your walk as a believer, that's what this chapter is talking about. Those whose faith made them do great things. And so faith plus action, if you would. If you look at chapter 10, verse 22, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. That's metaphorically talking about being washed with the water of the Word. Verse 23, let us hold fast the profession of our faith. Notice the profession of our faith. That's not just you speaking, what did you believe to be saved? If I ask you, what did you trust in to be saved? And you told me, I trusted that Christ died to pay for my sins. We call that a profession of faith. But this is talking about somebody's life, their manner, their conversation, their walk as a believer. And it's talking about drawing, he says, hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. Now that includes what you believe, and holding fast has to do with being willing to stand for your faith. Standing on it, not only repeating what you believe to others, but living a lifestyle that would complement the message that becomes the gospel of Christ, as Paul has put it. We're in verse 3, so look at 11 verse 3. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. Now, that kind of connects together that the things which are seen in the creation of the world, the things that you see, were not made by things which do appear. An example would be a road that is made, say, through a mountainous area. The engineers come in and they make a road. Well, that road is made by things which do appear. It took trucks, it took heavy equipment, it took whatever drills or mining or blasting or whatever it took to make that road through the mountains, but you could see and observe that process of building that road. Not so with the world and the universe. Those things were made not of things which appear. There weren't physical things that came together and made the world and made the universe. It was what the verse says, through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by what? By the word of God. God spoke and those things existed. Let there be light. And God made all the things that the earth, the stars, and everything around them in the universe were made by God's spoken word, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things what? Not seen. We believe in God. We believe in His word. We believe this is God's word because the book says it's his word. God claims this is my precious word that he exalts higher than his own name. The word of God is perfect just like God is perfect. And God has revealed through his word promises and prophecies. One third of the Bible has to do with things in the future that haven't yet been fulfilled. The word of God speaks of God, that Christ died for our sins. We've never seen the Lord Jesus Christ. We didn't see him crucified. Yet this book gives us strong assurance and confidence that he came and he died for our sins. Not only that, but God predicted many things in the Bible that have been fulfilled, and a lot of them with the appearing of the Lord Jesus Christ incarnate that we talk about this time of year, that he would come and these would be the signs of his coming, and this is what he would do in his ministry, this is what he would accomplish, and he fulfilled all those prophecies about him in his earthly ministry and will yet fulfill all the promises that he's given. But those things are, we believe those things about Christ that are based on the word of God. And we've never seen God, but we believe that he is, and that he's faithful to all the promises that he's given to us in his word. And so the chapter is, you know, the scriptures in verse 1 at the head of the chapter says, faith, talking about faith, is the substance of things hoped for. Your faith in God's word is strong. It's more than just having a hope-so understanding of things that God has promised you. You have a confidence, confident expectation of a sure thing is the definition of hope. And you have that because you base it on God's word. But the word of God and faith is powerful. When you access God's word by faith and stand by faith on verses, there's a power and a dynamic that comes from the word of God when you trust it. The word of God works effectually in you that believe, according to 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13, I believe. That faith, the word of God works effectually in you when you believe it. And so that's why it's so important to be established as a believer, because you're to walk in that doctrine, and the doctrine itself, when you access it by faith and obey it and are obedient to the faith, and you live that doctrine, it gives you power to live it. The word of God, God doesn't ask us to do anything that he doesn't give us the strength and the power to do. And we can do all things through Christ, which strengthens us. So the word of God is power when we take God at his word and walk by faith on his promises to us. Now, it's interesting that in this chapter, the example, he says first something practical, verse 2, for by faith the elders obtained a good report. Through faith, we what? Understand. A lot of chapters use the fact that God is the creator, the Lord Jesus Christ is the creator. God created all things as the substance that causes us to as the thing that we can we can see the creation. And when we do, according to Romans chapter 1, I can't talk about this without asking you to go with me to Romans 1. In Romans 1, the Apostle Paul's revelation, he writes in verse 16, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. So it's faith in God's word that's the power unto God, it's the power of God's salvation through faith in God's word to everyone that believeth. Faith effectually works in you. When you trust Christ died for your sins, that truth produces, God works salvation in you when you put confidence in his word and trust the gospel, justification unto eternal life. Verse 17, for therein is the righteousness of God revealed in the gospel. From faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. Faith to faith there is a reference to the faith of God to go to the cross and die to pay for our sins. God promised to do that before the foundation of the world. He was faithful. Christ came and he faithfully went to the cross. He prayed in the garden, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. He went to the cross knowing what would take place there. But God is faithful. You trust God to be faithful. You know he's trustworthy. So you trust that in what God says, that his son died to pay for your sins, to receive God's gift of eternal life, his promise to you. God who cannot lie, promise that salvation to you. Verse 18, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness. God's wrath is poured out against those who refuse to have God in their thinking as unbelievers. They try to put God out of their thinking. And unrighteousness of men, the wages of sin is death, who hold the truth in what? They have truth and understanding that they hold in unrighteousness. So they have the evidence of the world around them, God's creation, the stars at nighttime. They see all God's handiwork that's giving evidence. It's the substance of things. They have within them the God-given ability to look at creation and test, and that creation testify there is a God. That God gives to every person, as he says here in this passage. You don't have to convince somebody that there is a God. God gives them in their heart a conscience that tells every person that there is a God and they're going to give account to him one day. That's the grace of God, to give us a conscience, to convict us about the fact that we're going to be accountable to the Creator of all things. And that testimony that he is God is the creation around us. We can't look at it without realizing a powerful God created these things to perpetuate the plant kingdom, the animal kingdom, mankind. God put the seed inside those things to repeat generation after generation, reproduce, and so forth. So we look at creation, we look at the birth of a child, birth of an animal, we see the power of God to put inside the smallest things life that regenerates. And if you look here in the passage, he says, verse 19, why is it that they hold the truth in unrighteousness? Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them. Inside of them, for God has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of God, the things you can't see God, but those invisible things, that faith in him, from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, what? So that they are without excuse. There's no excuse to be an atheist or an unbeliever, because God's put that knowledge of himself in the heart of every man, and the testimony of God's creation confirms that. And the only way you can deny it is to refuse to accept what God has revealed within you and outside of you in his creation, that he is God. So that's important to realize. Genesis chapters 1 and 2. You know, some people don't want to accept this as the word of God. There are many that believe, they believe maybe the New Testament, but they think all the stuff in the Old Testament, German rationalism has tried to prove through the ages, that those stories, they're fables, they're not real, including Genesis 1 and 2. So they want to rationalize that the things in the universe took millions of years to form and come about. Layer upon it, you look at the Earth's crust and you cut away the ground, you see layer upon layer. That was millions of years. Where did that come from to accumulate on the Earth? Where did that matter come from? If God didn't create all things, where did the matter come from that the earth is made up of? I mean, they never can answer through evolution that there's not a creator. But they want to say, well, there today it's becoming accepted in higher level thinking that there is an intelligent design to the universe. But they want to jump right over God and say that there was an alien race that created the earth and seeded the earth. Of course they can't believe God, who says, I created the earth in Genesis 1 and 2 by his spoken word. They can't admit that. And so we have creation as testimony that God is who he says he is. Go to Psalm 33. And we're going to look at verse 6, Psalm 33, verse 6. So if you just look at a few of these evidences that God created all things, you could go to the book of Job. There's actually more information in the book of Job about creation than there is in Genesis 1 and 2. There's a lot of information in Job about God creating all things. But in Psalm 33, verse 6, we read, by the word of the Lord, by his word, were the heavens made, and all the host of them by the breath of his mouth. He gathereth the waters of the sea together as a heap. He layeth up the depth in storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. For he spake, and it was done. He commanded, and it stood fast. God's spoken word caused the things in this physical realm to come about. It didn't exist before God created it. God is a spiritual God. And the spiritual realm that God lives in is a different dimension than this physical realm that He created for us to live in. And so it's important to understand that God, who created all things, came and died for His creation on the cross. The unthinkable. You read about all the gods that were created, the heathen create these gods, man-made gods, and they carve statues to be the god, and then they bow down and worship the statue they carved. But they never have come up in their thinking that God that they worship died for them on their behalf. That would be weakness to a heathen, Gentile, human logic, human reasoning. Wouldn't think that the great and mighty God would lay down His life to His enemies so that He could pay for the ransom, the redemptive payment, redemption of our sins. But if you look at Isaiah 44, let's go there and take a look at the next passage, trying to get through these quickly. Isaiah 44, verse 24, start at verse 6. Thus saith the Lord, the King of Israel, and His Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first, and I am the last, and beside me there is no God. And who as I, shall call and shall declare it, and set an order for me, since I appointed the ancient people, and the things that are coming, and the things that shall come, let them show unto them. Fear ye not, neither be afraid. Have not I told thee from that time, and have declared it? Ye even are my witnesses. Is there a God beside me? And this is God speaking. Yea, there is no God. I know not any. If God the Creator doesn't know of any other gods in the universe, you can trust Him. There are no other gods, because He tells you there are none. So many, I don't care who sets up these gods in the earth, these false prophets, the Word of God, the book that claims to be written by God, the Creator of all things, tells us there are no other gods beside Him. Now look at verse 24. Thus saith the Lord, thy Redeemer, and He that formed thee from the womb, I am the Lord that maketh all things, that stretcheth forth the heavens alone, and spreadeth abroad the earth by myself. God claims that He made all things. There are no other gods that I know of in the world that claim that they made all things. And this verse tells of the verse 8, there are no other gods. Look at John chapter 1 now. John chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was, notice, the Word. By the Word of God were the heavens formed, right? In the beginning was the Word, capital W, Word. We know that's the second person of the Godhead. The Logos is another name for Him. It's the Greek word, I think, translated Word is Logos. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, talking about God the Father. And the Word was what? The Word was God. He, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Word of God, the living Word, is one of the Godhead. He is God. Verse 2, the same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. And if you look at verse 14, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. The Lord Jesus Christ, who made all things. How do you know the Lord Jesus Christ made all things? Because verse 3 says all things were made by Him. He is the second person, the Godhead. He is God. He made. When you see the God speaking in Genesis 1 and 2 that created all things, you're looking at the manifest person of the Godhead, the Lord Jesus Christ, creating all things. He's given credit in the New Testament scriptures with having been the member of the Godhead. Now, did all the Godhead make all things? Yes, because not one person of the Godhead doesn't do anything apart from the other members of the Godhead. You have verses that tell you that the Lord Jesus Christ created all things. And so we look now at Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 9. The Apostle Paul says unto me, who am less than, verse 8, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. They're unsearchable because God didn't promise riches to Gentiles in the Bible until the revelation given through the Apostle Paul. All the promises of riches in the Bible until Paul's epistles, Romans through Philemon, talk about God's promises to the nation of Israel to give them riches and blessing through the Abrahamic covenant, through the new covenant. But God interrupted that prophetic program in, we say, Acts chapter 9 with the raising up of the Apostle Paul. God set the nation of Israel aside between chapter 7 and chapter 9. God set the nation of Israel aside, and we learned through Paul that God had a purpose that he kept secret since the world began, and that purpose is to reconcile the heavenly government using the church, the body of Christ, as you read about in Colossians 1 and Ephesians 1. But Paul goes on to say, verse 9, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things, how? By Jesus Christ. So God, the Godhead, created all things by Jesus Christ. Go to Colossians now, the book of Colossians, companion book to the book of Ephesians. And in chapter 1 of Colossians, verse 15, we read, who is the image, about the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. So he was the firstborn from the dead, right? The Lord Jesus Christ was incarnate. He wasn't, when he was made flesh, we read about in Matthew and Luke, when he was made flesh, when he was born, when God, the second person, the Godhead who created all things, was made flesh, he pre-existed as God to create the whole universe, and then he took a body of flesh, as prophesied that he would, in order to be crucified, in order to be made flesh, and to have be made sin for us, that he might make us righteous. He's the firstborn from the dead in resurrection of every creature. Verse 16, for by him were all things created. So it's making the point, not that he was created when he was the firstborn and in incarnation, that wasn't his creation. He created all things that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions, principalities or powers. All things were created by him, visible and invisible. And he made the angels. He made Lucifer. He created all things. Who's more powerful, the thing created or the one that created those things? He's the creator. Nothing, everything is subject to him because he's the one that created all things. Look at, turn if you would now to Hebrews chapter 1 and look at verse 2. Verse 1, God who at sundry times and in divers manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. So God is, the Lord Jesus Christ, is the creator of all things. If you look at chapter 3, verse 4, it says, for every house is builded by some man, but he that built all things is God. Now, that's interesting to consider that. If you read on, he says, verse 3, for this man was counted, talking about Moses, worthy of more glory than, talking about Christ, the great high priest, in verse 1. This man was counted worthy of more glory than Moses, inasmuch as he who hath builded the house hath more honor than the house. What did Moses do? He was the first, created a nation through Moses, right? Well, through Abraham's seed that made the nation as he promised he would. But who's greater, the house? God created the earth. You know, many are trying to save the earth for God. It's up to them to save the earth from man, because man's going to destroy the earth. Who's greater, the earth or the one who created the earth? And they don't recognize God in their foolishness. But God who created the earth has promised what the end of the earth is going to be. You read about it in the book of Revelation. He's not going to let something destroy the world and what goes on it until he judges it and destroys it and makes a new heaven and new earth.